It's fall, so we kind of have that in mind, the fallow season. What's yellow, orange, and red and doesn't get hurt when it falls?
Leaves.
Autumn leaves. Very good. That was an easy one. Why did Humpty Dumpty have a great fall? To make up for a miserable summer. Did you hear about the tree that had to take time off work in autumn? It was on paid leave. Why are trees very forgiving? Because in the fall they let it all go, and in the spring they turn over a new leaf. Forgiveness practice, yeah. And then just, I thought this quote was just kind of interesting. It leads into the talk pretty well. It's not really funny, but somebody said, it's so strange that autumn is so beautiful, but everything is really dying. And I think that's a sense a lot of people have, that autumn's all about death, or it's very easy for us to let our attention go in that direction. We're heading toward a different color palette out there, right? From the yellow, oranges, and golds to shades of gray and brown, much more subtle color palette, and the leaves are all dropping from the trees. Fall took a little turn earlier this week, right? It kind of looked like winter for about a day and a half, maybe two, but we're still in the midst of the fall season, really up until the solstice, winter solstice, we're still in fall. And it is, like that quote suggests, a very paradoxical season, fall. Drawing here on, I read a little essay recently by Parker Palmer. Any of you familiar with Parker Palmer's work? I know you are, Elizabeth. Wonderful stuff. And he kind of brought this to my attention, what a paradoxical season autumn is. It's like death and life intermingled all around us. There's certainly deterioration and death, but tremendous growth. And we're not always as much aware of the tremendous growth as we are of the decline. Would you agree? We tend to gravitate to that. Here's a quote from Palmer. He says, autumn is a season of great beauty, but it's also a season of decline. The days grow shorter, and summer's abundance decays toward winter's death. Faced with this inevitable winter, what does nature do in autumn? She scatters the seeds that will bring new growth in the spring, and she scatters them with amazing abandon. I like that a lot. So I started doing some reading online about, well, what is going on in terms of reseeding and growth in the natural world around us in the fall, and found some lots of interesting things. He's right that most plants produce seeds in abundance because I guess nature knows that a lot of those seeds aren't going to take root because they'll get shaded out or they'll be gobbled up by creatures before they have a chance to. So there's a tremendous abundance of seeds spreading out around us. And the intricate ways plants find to do it is pretty amazing. We all know about like maple, ash, elm, tulip tree seeds that are winged and they come down like propeller blades and they kind of land all around. That was a little earlier in the fall. Some things like thistle, milkweed, dandelion, they blow far and wide through the wind. They're so light, they just blow around on the wind. Some spread through exploding pods. Our jewelweed plants have these pods and they get swollen and they pop and they go about several feet around the plant. It's kind of amazing. And then there's the burdock family, burdock seeds, cocklebur. These are the ones that stick to mammals, including us. You ever had any of these burrs on you? They get on all of us. They'll get on our pants or boots or whatever we've got. They'll get on our canine friends. We have one of our golden retrievers that's really fluffy, full fur. We call her a burr magnet. Anywhere she goes, anywhere near a wood line or anything, they just get on her. And they're real. I have to cut a lot of them out. They get in so bad. And sometimes they get on us that way, too. I remember having to throw out a pair of sweatpants or something because they were those little tiny seeds were embedded in there. So it was just, I can't deal with this. It's out. That's kind of an amazing survival feature of nature, isn't it? The way these things get out there. Some are, you know, in the form of nuts, you know, acorns, walnuts, hickories that drop from trees, and then rodents like chipmunks. Squirrels, they bury them everywhere. We've been removing some invasive honeysuckle lately. It seemed like everywhere I dug to pull something up, I'd find an acorn that was about to take root there that some industrious chipmunk or squirrel had buried there. Just amazing how much is going on. Right now, like late autumn is the time when trees and shrubs and perennials are focused primarily on deepening and expanding roots. All below underground, we have no awareness of it at all, but tremendous growth down at root level, deepening, spreading, expanding roots. I think that's, I learned so much just from observing and learning about the natural world. It's clearly, this means something for us too, I think, not just physically, but mentally and spiritually. In so supposedly autumnal or, you know, fallow seasons, when it seems like nothing is happening, or we've come to a stop for some reason, or we're stuck with some challenge or in some dark place, there may be a whole lot going on beneath the surface we're not aware of. A deepening and expansion of our roots, a receding that's going to lead to new growth if we can trust it and go with that. And having awareness of what's going on can be really helpful. It calls us to a shift in perspective, I think, on the autumn times, the fallow times, the times when it seems like nothing much is happening, or whatever is happening isn't right, or we're kind of stuck. I think we can draw some encouragement from the natural world, because in us too, it never stops. There's always growth going on. Sometimes we're just not seeing it. It's so beneath the surface. It's very consistent with Jesus' teachings, I think. There's a wonderful scripture I go back to in my memory often, because I think it demonstrates this higher vision that's possible if we shift our perspective a little bit. It's a teaching moment he seized with the disciples. This is a scripture from John 4:35, where they're obviously looking at a fallow season crop. They're looking at a field that's several months still from harvest and looks dead, probably. It looks like things would look in late fall or early winter. And the scripture goes, Jesus says, "Do you not say 4 months more, then comes the harvest? But I tell you, look around you and see how the fields are ripe for harvest." See how the fields are ripe. He saw something they didn't see, which is the indomitable, unstoppable, radiant life energy was flowing beneath the surface, all around. Germination was underway, and the harvest was, an inevitable thing. It was just about to happen. I think that's kind of a nice thing to reflect on in terms of how we look at things sometimes. We look like the disciples, and everything looks fallow, everything looks dead, nothing much happening. And we need that shift in perspective that Jesus had, which is a deeper understanding of how creation works and how creative energy is always flowing, and the indomitable life force we're all connected to, and what that makes possible for all of us. We're working against a kind of an old psychological faculty we human beings have that psychologists call our negativity bias. A negativity bias. Does that ring a bell? I've been aware of that. It's like, and we have that in effect sometimes when we're looking around at late autumn and approaching winter. It's like, winter's coming, death, decline, deterioration. Cold, very negative about the whole thing, and not aware at all of a lot of germination and receding and root expansion and deepening going on. We need to balance off that negativity bias that seems to come with the human package. It's probably a survival mechanism that goes way back to be in fear for the worst and preparing for it. But as we don't need that. We don't need that now. We need more of an opportunity to see, no, things aren't as dead as they seem. There's a lot going on beneath the surface. Obviously, we're not talking just about vegetation. We're talking about our human, our spiritual evolution, our growth that's always going on. And I think life teaches us. Sometimes it's more evident when we look back in retrospect, but I think life teaches us, if we're paying attention, to shift our perspective from what seems like all deterioration and loss to new growth going on. If we're receptive to that, this is what Parker Palmer said about that. He said, "In the autumnal events of my own experience, I'm easily fixated on surface appearances, the decline of meaning, the decay of relationships, the death of a work. And yet, if I look more deeply, I may see the myriad possibilities being planted to bear fruit in some season yet to come." I think we often can see that looking back, don't you? Difficult time, a transitional time. We all have them in our lives. It could be after a loss, a significant loss in our lives, a grief period. It could be after a divorce, or a lost relationship. It could be in retirement. It could be a shifting out of a workaday life to something new. It could feel like nothing is happening. Those kind of times, and then if we look back on them a little bit later, we'll go, wow, there was a lot going on. I learned so much during that period. I had to dig a little deeper, and I discovered so much. Anyone have that experience? Yeah. It's the human experience. The challenge is we don't always see it in the present, right? That's where it takes a little faith and a little wisdom to realize it's going on now, too. It's the human experience. Aging, just the basic aging process, it's easy to see that as deterioration and decline, right? Mostly loss of faculties and youthfulness and energy and things like that. I don't have the same knees I had in my 20s. But we have to remind ourselves too, boy, there's this germination, this growth, this expansion of spiritual roots of that makes possible deepening a higher evolution of selfhood that's going on all the time despite surface appearances of loss. Lots of stories of it. We could all tell stories of it from our lives, but I found myself thinking again about a church member, my church many years ago, a former church, wonderful man named Joseph. He had been a priest in an earlier life, and his spirituality got too big for one faith, and he left the priesthood, and happened to marry a woman who had been a nun and had gone through a similar process of finding she didn't quite fit into that niche anymore. Their spirituality was just too wide-ranging for that. And they married, and they had a daughter, and a lot of wonderful years together. It was like a 25-year marriage. And then out of the blue, Joseph's wife requested a divorce. She'd never experienced independence, and she wanted to. She'd gone from being a nun to being married, raising a child. She had a desire, calling for something else in her. And it was a devastating time of loss for Joseph. What's life gonna be about now? Where's the purpose of it? Where's the meaning of it? He was retired from the job he had taken up after priesthood. So we have a lot of time to reflect. Sometimes life orchestrates it that way. You know, we have a lot of time on our hands all of a sudden when we're in these autumnal periods. Anyone had that experience? And it's time we can put to good use by being open to what kind of deepening is going on here and being alert to the guidance that might be coming to us in that period. Maybe spend a little more time in meditation or staying in touch with God in us in whatever ways works for us. What happened to Joseph was he became interested in, it was early days for hospice work, but he became interested in hospice. And he dropped into a hospice inpatient a facility with the offices there and offered to serve or help in some way. As a former priest, he had a calling for service to others. And the person interviewing him said, why do you want to become you've never done this before or used hospice yourself in the past, why do you want to do that? And he said, well, hospice is about dying, right? And helping people who are dying. He says, I feel like I'm dying. Felt like he was dying, and hospice was the place to go. There's some deep guidance came to him that drew him in that door, and some deep guidance guided the person he interviewed with that day because she understood this is kind of divinely guided. He's meant to help us out. He's meant to share his gifts with us. He'll be a blessing to us. He'll be a blessing to others. She found a niche for him right away in their grief and bereavement area. Particularly the people who make contact with people who have lost loved ones all through that first year when holidays come around and birthdays and anniversaries, getting back in touch to see how are you doing. And he did that mostly by phone, and that became his new calling in life. And he found it richly satisfying, and he brought to it deeper roots, an expanded sense of self than he'd had in the past, that he'd learned from going through a difficult transition like that. Sometimes we have no way of knowing what we're being prepared for, what the next deeper step is going to be in our becoming process. We just have to trust it's going on, that there's reseeding going on, there's germination, there's a deepening of roots that's going to allow for a bolder, a bigger selfhood that's going to grow in that space. We watched it's also true how we reseed and spread also in terms of our influence in our communities and among others. Isn't that a way we reseed also? Those with the young ones and grandchildren, you see the seeds you've planted, what you've fostered in others, really expanding and taking root and spreading their seeds out around. How that spreads. There's a lot of richness and meaning that comes from that, a lot of deepening of our sense of ourselves. In our work lives, people everywhere, whether you have families or not, the people you've mentored or managed or helped in some way or served in some way, that all sparks a reseeding and a spreading out of these divine gifts that deepens us even as we spread them far and wide. We watched again last night an old movie, a favorite of mine, called Mr. Holland's Opus. Anybody remember the movie? It goes back to 95, I think. We watched it again last night because I was remembering it as I was putting some notes together. It was a teacher who, you know, down through the years often felt like he wasn't, you know, using his gifts. He wasn't making much of a difference. He was struggling against shrinking school budgets that cut art and music programs and challenges at home and overworked for, you know, not enough money and all these different challenges that can make you feel like you're not doing much of anything, you're not having any influence, or you're not growing, you're not using your gifts. And then, of course, there's this wonderful final scene of Mr. Holland, who he's kind of forced into retirement because they've canceled the music program at his school. This is based on a real guy, by the way, a man named Glenn Holland, who was a music teacher and composer, wanting to compose but needing to teach, and then falling in love with teaching. But he felt like it was just all a waste. You know, at 60, he was kind of forced into early retirement, and you know, what was it going to be about now? And then they all came back. Do you remember the final scene? That's what we saw. All the former students and fellow teachers and everybody came back and celebrated and honored him. And it was this huge demonstration, a huge auditorium full of people. And he led his opus that he'd been working on for many years with a combined orchestra of former students who came back. And, oh, it's a real tearjerker kind of scene. You have to watch that if you haven't before. But what it demonstrates, this is what I find so touching about that scene, is none of us know how many lives we touch. None of us. And we very often underestimate and discount what we're doing in our lives. I have the blessing often of doing memorial services, facilitating memorial services for people, and it happens so often that just people come out of the woodwork and come back because they want to say thank you and goodbye. It's a mystery how people find out about these services sometimes. It's not like they're advertised widely, but people find their way back because they've been touched in some way. You get just a tip of the iceberg glimpse of how the influence of human life, when they have spread a little kindness, when they've shared their gifts in a way that they hope will be a blessing to loved ones, to neighbors, to their community. When I did Joseph's memorial, years after he took up that hospice work, people heard about that service and came back to celebrate him. He probably would have been amazed were there. And there were some people who came that they knew him only as a voice on the phone, a kind person who called them once in a while to see how they were in a difficult time. There's a lot going on in the fallow seasons of our life, and if we can kind of remember that, maybe we can shift our perspective a little bit on those times when we're going through them, you know, in the moment of our discontent, of our confusion, our sense of lost meaning, lost faculties, online, deterioration. Maybe we can remind ourselves, I've been through times like this before. I know it's a part of the natural world. It's a part of me. The growth is always going on. If not on the surface here, down below, deep inside, there's this receding going on and this deepening and expansion of roots. It's always going to lead me toward greater life. And I believe very firmly that it continues even beyond this life plane. So at one point, that deepening and that expansion of roots is going to propel us onward. We know not where, but that same growth process is going to unfold. I've always loved the way Myrtle Fillmore exited this plane. Those of you who have read a little about Myrtle Fillmore, she lived into her 80s, somewhere in her mid to late 80s, I think. But on her last couple of days, she went into Silent Unity, where she was in charge of the prayer room there, and said her goodbyes to folks. And someone said to her, we don't want you to leave us, Myrtle. And she said, I can continue my work now better from the other side. I don't know what she saw, but she certainly perceived it and knew the same unlimited growth, germination, deepening, expansion was going to keep going on, and she was ready to kind of do it in a more unlimited way on the other side now. I want to go that way. How about you?
Yeah.
So we remember that in all the tough times of our lives, no matter when, no matter at what point in our lives, life is always about receiving germination, deepening, new growth, new life. It's always underway, and we are a part of that, and it's a part of us. So here's my affirmation for this week, if you want to join me in it in a moment. Being one with creative source, life grows in me constantly. Together? Being one with creative source, life grows in me constantly. Let's take that into prayer for a moment and affirm it within. Deepen our minds and hearts. We are connected. We are deeply God-connected beings. This source within us that is the fount of all we need. Renewing energy. Unfailing life. Guiding wisdom. Steadying peace. We are connected with all of this at depth. And it is always guiding us toward new growth, toward an expanded sense of who we are, toward new life and new opportunities. Thank you, God, for your unfailing presence with us now and always. Amen.